Friends, welcome to the topic arbitration. As we know, the construction industry plays a significant role in the development of the nation. Construction is an important sector that contributes greatly in the economic growth of nation. The construction industry is an investment-led sector where government shows high interest. Government contracts with construction industry to develop infrastructure related to health, transport, as well as education sector. Any construction industry project involves two parties. One party is government body, which is usually called as client, and another is private party, which are contractors, suppliers, or service providers. However, over the last few decades, this significant increase in the construction industrial activities, accompanied by considerable increase in the number of commercial disputes as well. Every industry is subject to variety of disputes, whether intentional or domestic. Financial and other implication of such disputes vary from one company to another company, depending upon the facts and circumstances of each case. Alternative dispute resolution mechanisms like arbitration have become more important for operating businesses in India. Being a civil engineer, we must have a knowledge of arbitration, need of arbitration in civil engineering, arbitrators, its qualification, duties and powers. So friends, in this video lecture, we are going to discuss all these topics in detail. The very first is arbitration. One must understand and know meaning of arbitration. Arbitration is a process by which dispute between the parties is settled outside the court by the third person. That third person is called as an arbitrator. What exactly is the role of arbitrator? An arbitrator is a person to decide the dispute outside the court. He may be appointed either by the parties or by the court. There may be sole arbitrator or panel of arbitrators. Whether the arbitrator is a sole person or panel, it is called a arbitral tribunal. So, as the construction industry increasing rapidly, it leads to the different disputes between the client and the contractor. So, here are some points which discusses about the need of this arbitration in the construction industry. The very first is, the arbitration means that the decision maker is an experienced industry professional instead of lay jury. Now, what is mean by lay jury? So, lay jury is nothing but the ordinary citizens who are working together with the legal judges, and by that they are giving the judgment over any case. So, obviously, the arbitrators are the experienced industrial professionals, so definitely they will give a very sound judgment on the dispute. Second is, arbitration can provide a better protection for your asset by minimizing your risk of large losses sometimes seen with the jury verdicts. So usually it is seen that there are chances of losses, huge losses in terms of money, in terms of time also, during the court cases and all. So arbitration can provide you a better protection for your asset by minimizing this risk. Next is, arbitration can provide a flexibility in scheduling versus court, where you are told when and where to show up without much room to negotiate. So in arbitration, arbitrator can give a flexibility in scheduling where to take the meeting of arbitration, where to schedule in which language. So there is a lot of flexibility in contrast with the court judgments. Arbitration can put an end to your case faster. The time taken by arbitrator is usually less than that to get a case to court to resolve a construction disputes. So as we talked about, the time required in the entire process of court cases and all is very more huge in comparison to that. The arbitration, the cases ends faster than in the court. So that is one more advantage that we are getting in the arbitration. Arbitration cost can be much less when compared to the one charged during any other legal processes like litigation and all. So here the charges in terms of money, the money required in case of arbitration is less as compared to the court cases. But that arbitrator who is going to settle the dispute should have certain qualification. Instead of that person could not be a good arbitrator. So the person designated to be appointed as an arbitrator must possess the below mentioned qualifications. The first one is confidence of parties. Both the parties, client and contractor, should have equal confidence on that arbitrator. In that case only that arbitrator can be called for the settlement of dispute. Next is impartiality. Arbitrator should be impartial. He should not have a personal interest in any one of the party, and he should give a impartial judgment. Technical and legal qualification. Arbitrator should have thorough technical and legal knowledge. In that case only he can study the case in detail. Extensively he can give the judgment to particular case. Then disinterested parties to litigation aka no conflict of interest. What does it means? The conflict of interest is a situation in which an internal auditor who is in position of trust has a competing professional or personal interest. Such competing interest can make it difficult to fulfill his or her duties impartially. In short, we can call it as if any arbitrator is having professional or personal interest in any one of the party, in that case he will not give a proper judgment, or that judgment will not be impartial. So there should not be any conflict of interest. In that case only that arbitrator can be called off for the arbitration. Next and last is he should be able to enter into the contract with regard to the adjunction of the arbitration agreement. So with this qualification, there are certain powers with the arbitrator. So an arbitrator is empowered to make award which is a binding on the parties. The parties has an authority to award, to grant interest if there is a debt payable with interest. The power of the arbitrator or arbitral tribunal may be explained under the following heads. The very first is power to make a awards. Award means to give the judgment. So arbitrator is having all the rights, all the powers to give a proper judgment to any one of the party. Next is power to take assistance. In any case, there may be one or two arbitrator. As the case may be, as per the requirement, that arbitrator can call another arbitrator in case of any complication and all. So he can call another arbitrator and can solve and settle the disputes in assistance with that arbitrator. Next is power to rule on its jurisdiction. Every arbitrator is having its extent of power. Within that only he has right to act accordingly. Those powers are laid by the court or the laws. Next is a power to pass interim relief. Then determination of rule of procedure. As per the case, the arbitrator is having all the rights, powers to determine the rules, and accordingly he can proceed the arbitration process and will give the judgment. Then power to determine the place of arbitration. With the free consent, the arbitrator is having all the powers to decide the place of arbitration. Then the language. Language may not be the barrier during the dispute resolution. So therefore, with the free consent of both the parties, arbitrator decides the language, and in that language the judgment is given. Next, settlement of claim and defenses. Then hearing and writing procedure. Arbitrator can settle the claims. Claims means it is a claiming or settling the sum of money. Then hearing and writing the procedure. So arbitrator will attend the hearing, and accordingly during the hearing he will write the minutes, which is called as a proceeding. So arbitrator is having all the rights to attend the hearings and to write the procedure or the minutes of that particular hearing. Then default of party. Default of party, it means a party fails to appear at an oral hearing or to a procedure to produce documentary evidence. The arbitral tribunal may continue the proceeding and make an arbitral award on the evidence before it. So in short, it means in absence of any party, the arbitrator will attend the hearing and will proceed accordingly, will also produce the documentary evidences if required, and accordingly the judgment is awarded. So in absence of any party, arbitrator can attend and will attend the hearing. He will continue the proceeding and the judgment is awarded. Next is power to appoint an expert. If necessary, if any technical complications are there, more sound technical knowledge if it is required, then in that case, arbitrator can call an expert also. Then the power to seek a court assistance in taking evidences. So if required, in case of more complicated cases, and if the dispute cannot be solved easily, in that case arbitrator will seek the court assistance. Next is award and settlement power. He has all the powers and rights to award or to give the judgment to any one of the party. Then power to terminate proceedings, to stop the proceedings, to stop the hearing. All the powers are held with the arbitrator. Power of correction and interpretation of award plus additional rewards. After giving the judgment, if required, if arbitrator fails, he can correct that judgment and he can interpret, and he may award an additional reward also. Next is power to impose interest and deposits. Then remuneration powers. And last is power as to lien or arbitral award and deposit as to cost. So here we have discussed about the different rights that any one arbitrator is having. But along with that, that arbitrator has to discharge certain duties. And those duties are an arbitrator has a certain essential obligation and duties as below. Very first is equal treatment of parties must be impartial. So it is a prime duty of any arbitrator to give the equal treatment to both the parties, and he should be impartial. While giving the judgment, the arbitrator should be impartial. Second is the concern with the disputes only. It is a prime duty of arbitrator that he should discuss about the dispute only and should not discuss any other thing not related to that particular case. So he should be concerned with the dispute only. Arbitrator has to follow the provision of 1996 Act. His duty is towards the public policy. He should follow all the public rules, and within that rule, within that frame of constraint, the arbitrator should give the judgment. Then obligation towards time limitation. The arbitrator should settle or resolve the case in limited time period. He should not extend the case or that process. Next is obligation towards the remuneration. Then reasoned award in accordance with the act. Next is the principle of natural justice. So the principle of natural justice is based on the three main principle we can call as a governing principle. The first is hearing rule. So there should be a fair opportunity for both the parties to express their views and to defend themselves. So this first principle is hearing rule. Next is a bias rule, that expert arbitrator should be biased free while taking the decision. Third and most important principle is reasoned decision. Decision or judgment of the court given by the preceding authorities with the valid and reasonable ground. So he should be arbitrator should give a reasoned decision, valid decision with the reason. Next is a duty to withdraw or recuse. So here he should withdraw, he can withdraw himself from the case because of the potential conflict of interest or lack of impartiality. Suppose, in case if the arbitrator feels like he will not be impartial anymore with any party because of any professional or the personal interest, at that moment of time, arbitrator can withdraw himself from that case. Because ultimate aim of the arbitration is to settle the dispute and have a proper judgment in that case. So if suppose any arbitrator feels that he will not be impartial anymore, he should withdraw himself from that particular case. Then next is he should not act beyond his jurisdiction. As discussed earlier, he is abided with the laws and court laws. So arbitrator should act between that frame of constraint and between that extent of powers only. He should not act beyond his jurisdiction. He should not be guilty or fraud or misconduct. It means that he should not be guilty under any act. There should not be any legal charges or criminal cases on that arbitrator. In that case, only that arbitrator can act, can process the arbitration process. Next is a duty of finality and reasonableness, that any arbitrator should have conclusiveness and fairness in judgment. At certain point, he should have that ability to conclude the case with the fair judgment. So that is the meaning of that point. Next is must act judiciously and follow the rules of justice, equity, and good conscience. It means the arbitrator must act thoroughly and ethically. Then should decide the dispute according to law. Then duty to render accounts, duty towards usage according to trade. So the practice of that arbitrator should be professional. Very professionally he has to think about the case, and he should give the judgment to one party. And the last one, duty towards the settlements. So anyhow, any arbitrator should be capable of settling the dispute, and he must settle the dispute and come to the conclusion with the fair judgment to one party. So these are certain duties of arbitrators. So I hope, friends, you have understood all the concept of arbitration. What is meant by arbitrator? What are the qualification, duties and powers that any arbitrator is having? So thank you very much.